So we are going to get into all things Vols and Bowling Green over the course of the next 3 hours. Adam Sparks of the Knoxville News Sentinel will be here. Lucas, why does my grid say Adam effing Sparks?
Because it's game day.
What are you doing? You kind of yelled at me this morning. Do you want to tell the audience what happened?
What about you calling me and Ramon Foster weird?
Yeah.
I mean, you're just like...
Oh, I said you're sick.
Oh, we're sick, yes.
Yeah, you're sick.
you called Ramon Foster sick because he's decked out in his UT gear. He's wearing his game-worn Tennessee football helmet, which is awesome.
Also sick.
Look at that face mask. It looks so old school.
Is it in here?
It's through the multiple layers of plexiglass over here kind of in front of me.
Oh, I can't see it.
But it is in the studio where that big giant fireball thing used to be.
Oh, my God. That thing looks like it's from 1985.
It's from, like, 2008.
Okay. Same thing.
I came in. I wore it. I tried it on. It looks better on Ramon.
Did you let out a war cry? Did you feel the need to put eye black on after the fact?
Well, yeah. I immediately felt those pregnant vibes you were talking about that, right off the top. But... No, you called Ramon sick because he's decked out in his UT gear. I said, no, you're the sick one. You're the weird one for not having a football team, for not being a fan of anything other than IU basketball, which is fair. It's where you went to school. But no, you're the weird one here in this building, Buck Rising, not us.
Look at that. Spicy on this game day. 615-737-1045 is how you jump in. What are you most excited to see from the Vols tonight? We will also I'm just going through the grid now. So not only will we have Adam effing Sparks up next, we will have Joey MFing Kent. Volunteer fame at 12:20, so stick around for that. We're also going to talk today about some statistics. Because I told Lucas, I saw the 35-point spread. Okay, I saw that the Vols are favored at home by 35. I immediately bet Bowling Green in my DraftKings Sportsbook app, code WGFX. And Lucas was like trying to talk me off the ledge about it. Now he's pissed off for greatness. He's fired up. He's ready to go this morning. And yeah, I'm excited too. There are some things that I'm interested to see, but like, I'm not full blown homer, even though I do have a volunteer orange shirt on today, which is complete and utter circumstance. It is baseball, however, that I'm wearing for the Vols game day. 615-737-1045. We'll talk about Jurrell Casey momentarily. But people are passionate. People are fired up to talk Vols today. So why don't we start that off? Start the show off with a little cheeseburger. What's going on, cheeseburger? Long time no talk.
Yo.
What's up? All right, cheeseburger. Good,
good talk.
Good effort. What? Really?
Yo.
Okay, so is this the omen that we're talking about, like the idea that we immediately go to the phones and it's like an omen for game day, right?
Look, I love cheeseburger. Love cheeseburger. He doesn't have that kind of power.
You don't think so? This is not like the Vol Navy ship on fire before the Georgia State game?
No, cheeseburger's crappy phone line in like Cheatham County or whatever it is. It's not equivalent to a boat blowing.
What do you tell me every time I laugh at one of the names of these places or these cities or these counties? What do you... You say, hey, easy. Easy,
easy,
big guy.
Easy.
You must respect the culture, as Rhett Bryan would say. 615-737-1045. All right, cheeseburger blew it. Let's see if Zach's any better. Zach is in Murfreesboro. He wants to talk about the Vols today. What's up, Zach?
What's up, man? Listen, super excited to see Joe Milton throw the freaking football around Neyland. Second of all, go Big Orange, 14-0 this year. We're going to win the national championship.
Oh, I'm so happy. 615-737-1045. I swear to God, it is unlike anything. And this is the beauty of sports, right? It doesn't matter how awful last year went for any team. I'm not making this Vol specific. It doesn't matter how bad your season ended or how poorly you played throughout the course of your, I guess in the case of the SEC, 10-game schedule, or how you finished in your season finale, or what happened, who your coach is or is not, or how many players you lost to the transfer portal, or how poorly you did in recruiting. When it's time for game day, all that washes away. That's a beautiful thing. I really do have a great appreciation for that. So yeah, I'm the weird one. That's okay. Somebody has to be the balance here today, because clearly None of it. Ramon Foster, not capable of balance this morning. Lucas Panzeca, not capable of balance this morning.
No, in fact,
it was starting to leak out yesterday when you saw him spitting at Georgia fans about what I can't even remember what you were pissed off at Georgia fans about.
I wasn't spitting at anybody.
You were, absolutely. Just as you spat at me this morning over the phone, no, you're the weird one. Because I wasn't walking into work wearing a Tennessee Vols helmet from 2008. I'm the weird one. 615-737-1045. Yeah, Joe Milton is fascinating, right? Because we've talked about this at length. Joe Milton, the starting quarterback for the Vols tonight, he has a golden opportunity to at least build a foundation, give his teammates, his coaching staff, you as a fan base, he has the ability to give you some groundwork, lay some groundwork tonight against a just understandably wretched football team in Bowling Green. Like, you could not set this up on a tee any better for him to knock out of the park. Joe Milton has the ability tonight to show you what this offense, one, is capable of, two, that he is not the same player that he was at Michigan because the offense wasn't built to suit him there, and they have specifically brought him in because he suits their offense, well, not here, but in Knoxville. He has the ability to generate, you know, it's okay to start to have hope if you see the product on the field, be exciting. The defense may not be very good. We don't have to get into that just yet. You're playing a game at home where you're a 35-point favorite. You got a new coach. You got a new quarterback for the first time in 150 years because JG is playing off somewhere in Washington State or something like that. Isn't that right, Washington State? Jarrett Garantano, for the first time in what feels like my entire lifetime, is not starting a game for the Tennessee Volunteers at quarterback. Oh, Coach Mack is in the building. What is going on, big dog? I won't put him on a microphone. He just, what a lovely surprise.
Nothing brightens your day like that.
No, nothing brightens your day than Mack giving, well, he's giving horns up right now, but it's usually horns down for the big man. What's going on, Mack? Oh, he just left me hanging. Just walked right by. I went to fist bump him. Just walked right by me. The disrespect. Well, you can see me in my element. You can see this is basically your home because you've got so many bobblehead cutouts hanging around here, Mac. For all the people, he says it makes him happy. Indeed. It always makes us happy to see Coach Mac. Enjoy your recording, Mac. I'll talk to you later. What the hell is going on around here today?
I want that every day. Just a
random Mac pop in.
Just a Mac stroll through the studio.
He just doddering around the studio on the camera, you know, taking a lap, seeing all the sights. He said he wants to see me in my element. It makes me very happy. 615-737-1045. Trevarian is in Nashville. He wants to talk about the Vols today. What's up? You got me?
How you doing?
I'm great, buddy.
Hey, okay, so UT is going to put the beat down on Bowling Green tonight.
Sure.
Yeah. Bowling Green, they got $1.2 million to come down here to get the beat down. The money line is atrocious. The top end points since the season started is 45. I think they'll do 30. Money line is at 60. If you want to make some easy money, go with UT under 65.
Oh, okay. I like that. Hey, what's your 900 your 900 number to get your picks?
Are you going to give that out on the air? I'll give you some more later.
I love it. I appreciate the call, boss. Enjoy the game tonight and potentially some winnings. 615-737-1045. I love it. There's juice. Here, because you call me a weirdo, because I'm not, this is a foreign concept to me. Okay, what we're talking about here, like game day for a fan, that's opening day. I don't do that during football season, right? Game day for me is a job on Sundays because I'm going to work a Titans game. Game day for me does not feel like this until basically November because of my basketball background. But I would kill, absolutely kill to see a game at Neyland Stadium. Now, the bye week doesn't work out to where I can go for a home game this year, but that is absolutely a bucket list because you talk about 102,000 people that are this passionate about a university, no matter the lows, no matter the highs, this runs so deep in people's, you know, family dynamic, in their blood, basically. Season tickets passed down generationally, and all the memories that come with it, from Peyton Manning to Reggie White to, you know, Josh Dobbs, the whole nine, right? This is something that I love because I can feed off of it. And you guys can absolutely, you know, it's the best thing about sports. It's game day. So that's what we're going to do today. Now, we're also going to talk about Jurrell Casey because he is retiring basically right after the show ends at 1 o'clock today at Nissan Stadium. So a Titans legend, Lucas. Lucas was also cursing the name of Jurrell Casey because he demanded that we have one day without Titans. Titans stuff, given that it is his precious Vols game day. Are you bitter at Jurrell Casey for retiring today?
No. Love Jurrell Casey. I don't think that's true. But it's like, come on,
I think you're lying to the audience. I really do.
No. I do have the Vols game you can go to, by the way. The Ole Miss game on October 16th is the Monday Night Football weekend where the Titans play the Bills.
Oh, do you want to go?
I plan on going because that's the only game I can go to due to the Titans.
Road trip. Maybe we do a show road trip. Look at us planning things on air again. Again, I'm going to get a call from a lawyer during the commercial break. Don't cut it out. Knock it off. You can't plan trips on air. All right, fine. What we are going to talk about coming up next, though, is expectations, things to watch, the areas of concern, what to expect from game one of the Tennessee Volunteers under Josh Heupel. Your phone calls as well, 615-737-1045. Benny Mike with the perfect walk-off to end this segment. He said on YouTube, where you can interact with us on Zone TV, Benny Mike says, Buck, it's so bad I set my thermostat to 98 when I left for work today. Because you know what? Any day that it's the first day that the Vols play a game, baby, it feels like 98 all over again. I'm Buck Rising. This is 104.5 The Zone.
They don't make them like Jurrell Casey.
Quarterback draw. Instead, he's sacked! Jurrell Casey sells out to make the play.
Congratulations on your retirement from 104.5 The Zone.
Individual results may vary.
At LASIKMD Nashville, we invite you to see more and pay less. With LASIK starting at $490 per eye and the lowest price guaranteed, freedom from glasses and contacts has never been more affordable. LASIKMD is one of North America's leading LASIK providers, and Dr. Greenberg has performed over 80,000 procedures. That's experience you can trust. The LASIK procedure is quick and there is little downtime. Most patients are back in action within 24 hours, so you can be out on the town with clear vision the next day. Book your free consultation today at LASIKMD.com.
Who decided you have to be on the golf course to get a mulligan? Download the TwinSpire Sportsbook app right now and you'll unlock a good old-fashioned mulligan up to $1,000 if your opening bet misses the win column. Just use code FREE1000 and take your swing with up to a $1,000 risk-free bet at TwinSpire Sportsbook. Void where prohibited. For terms and conditions, visit TwinSpires.com. Offer valid for new players only. Must be 21 and over and physically present in Tennessee to bet. For help with a gambling problem, call or text the Tennessee Red Line at 800-889-9789.
Hi, this is Lance Drury with the Lance Drury Law Firm here in Nashville. I've been warning our clients that IRS employees are back at work since mid-July, and their collection efforts have ramped up. Well, sure enough, it looks like it's happening. So if you have unfiled tax returns, wage levies, bank levies, or tax liens, now's the time to call the Lance Drury Law Firm before the IRS calls you. Tax resolution plans are based off your current income. So if your current income is less than normal due to the COVID-19 pandemic, this is precisely the time for the Lance Drury Law Firm to help you. Your consultation is free, so don't put it off. The Lance Drury Law Firm focuses solely on tax resolution law. It's all we do. And if you have IRS problems, you have legal problems. Let us use our tax law resolution experience to guide you and work on your custom resolution plan. Call now. It's free and confidential. Call me, Lance Drury, at 615-733-8168 or go to LanceDrurylaw.com.
The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely upon advertisements.
Eyes, teeth, we love your whole face. Protect your employees' overall health by adding Delta Dental and Delta Vision plans to your benefits package. These plans offer cost savings and the largest networks of providers. Learn more at DeltaDentalTN.com.
We can see your smile, and we think you should be able to see it too. With Delta Dental of Tennessee and Delta Vision, we can improve your overall well-being by keeping your teeth and eyes healthy. Visit DeltaDentalTN.com to find an affordable plan.
Don't just watch the game. Be a part of the action with WynnBET. We've got your ticket to every straight bet, parlay, teaser, and props wager, all right at your fingertips. The WynnBET app is easy to use, so play with the most trusted brand in the industry. Download the app for free on Google Play or the Apple Store today. It's time to get off the sidelines and put yourself in the game. Win with WynnBET. Must be 21 or older and present in Tennessee to bet. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-889-9789.
Selling your home can be stressful. Hey, this is Dawn Davenport. Get a guaranteed offer from Mark Spain Real Estate and receive the strongest cash offer on your home.
Tennessee Volunteers, 104.5 The Zone, kickoff, 7 p.m. Central Time. You guys want to get in? You want to express your excitement? You want to talk about the game? We're doing it all day long. Adam Sparks of the Knoxville News Sentinel, who now covers the Tennessee Volunteers, will join us momentarily. But let's go to the phones in the meantime, because you guys are waiting patiently. Let's go to Eddie in Nashville, who wants to talk about these Volunteers. What's up, Eddie?
Hey, on I-40 headed to Knoxville, going to see a great game tonight. I'm going to be really disappointed if there's not a warrant issued against the team tomorrow for premeditated murder.
That's not where I thought. That's not where I thought Eddie was going. I love it.
Yeah, I don't know if you heard the Kessling show last night. They had the play-by-play announcer for Bowling Green on there.
Okay.
And he made the point that there's only one player on their offense that's played a snap in an actual game for them.
Oh, is it the quarterback that's got one touchdown and six interceptions?
Yes, he's the only one that's got game experience.
Outstanding. Thank you for the call, Eddie. Enjoy the game. 615-737-1045 is the number. He said, I'm going to be pissed off if the Vols are not arrested for premeditated murder. That's the energy that they've got against Bowling Green tonight. I love it. Man, there's a lot of stuff that's legitimately exciting, though. Not just because it's game day, not just because it's a refresh, not just because it's a new season, but because you have something, you have the promise of a product that is going to be exciting to watch. We're going to talk over the course of really the 11 o'clock hour, and if you guys want to get involved before, let's go to Adam Sparks, who is here and is writing now for the Knoxville News Sentinel covering the University of Tennessee. It still sounds weird coming out of my mouth, and I know the Vols fans are, you know, adopting you like one of their own. Adam, what's going on, buddy?
Not bad. Yeah, I'm adjusting also. This week I was in a grocery store here in Knoxville. I was looking for somebody to help me find something, and I was looking for people with like the polo shirt of that store.
Yeah.
And I couldn't find them, and then I quickly realized everybody was in orange. Every worker was in orange. Cause it's not just game day here, it's like game week. Everybody in my cul-de-sac is in orange. You can't go anywhere without seeing somebody in orange. So I'm adjusting to it. It's a college town.
I'm pretty sure it's 10:23 a.m. Central Time here in Nashville, and I'm pretty sure half of my callers are drunk because some man just asked or just demanded that the Vols commit premeditated murder tonight against Bowling Green. So that's the kind of energy that we welcome in our buddy Adam Sparks with. So the point spread is 35. We know the ineptitude of Bowling Green a year ago. So let's focus on this Vols team. Outside of Joe Milton, the starting quarterback, because we'll talk about him shortly, who is the most important player on the field tonight?
I'll have to split that between a couple of Tyon Evans and Jabari Small. It's one position, it's running back, because all the talk that we have about Milton and his ability to, they hope to throw the ball. This offense by Josh Heupel is billed as a running offense, and that's what they were at UCF too. It was run, run, run to set up the pass, and even the deep balls that Josh Heupel loves a lot come off of that run. They'd go up tempo, but they like to run the ball a lot, and those two guys, Tyon Evans, junior college transfer, Jabari Small from Briarcrest out of Memphis. Jabari Small is more of a kind of a scat back, catch the ball out of the backfield. Tyon Evans is sort of a bowling ball type, 5'11", 220, a physical, compact runner. And if those guys can run the ball well against sort of a rebuilt offensive line, then that will make Joe Milton's job so much easier. And they have to have that for the games against Pitt next week and some of these toss-up games in the SEC. Joe Milton at Michigan, when he played well, it's when he had a running game. Other factors have to come together too, but when he had a running game, he was pretty good. UCF's offense was always good when they had a running game. So if UT can run the ball well tonight, it at least gives you the hint that they can do that a little bit in the games ahead. They have to have that SEC play.
Now, the Vols offensive line, it's definitely looks different than it did a year ago, understanding what the transfer portal and graduation, things of this nature, have done to it. But still, two former five-star prospects and four in 2020, after featuring four in 2020, they need Cade Mays and Darnell Wright to really perform up to expectation. What is kind of the thought process with this unit? What is the decision on the starting five tonight, and how cohesive do we expect them to be?
Yeah, Darnell Wright's a guy that he's lost 20 pounds this offseason. He's lost 40 pounds since this time last year. And that's to take advantage of his athleticism, moving from right tackle to left tackle. He was a high end recruit when he came here. He's a junior now. It's time for him to kind of come into his own. You know, Cade Mays being, at least he's listed at right tackle tonight, I think that's where he'll start out. That's not a great sign for UT because he's better at guard. He's a early round pick in the NFL draft as a guard. The fact that they have to move him to tackle tells you that they do have some depth concerns there. You know, the offensive line's coached by Glenn Ellerbe, who I covered and people may remember around there, was a really good offensive lineman at MTSU many years ago. Ellerbe came into camp saying, I think I've got at least 10 guys I can count on to start. You kind of heard behind the scenes that number has dropped to 8, 7, 6. And I think right now that's where they're at. They have a starting five, and they have maybe a six guy, Dane Davis, at the other at a tackle that they can pull in. They've got to develop some depth there. It's going to be fine against Bowling Green tonight. But again, once they get to the Pitt game and the SEC games, they're going to have some depth there. And they won't need it tonight. They'll need it then.
Adam Sparks of the Knoxville News Sentinel here with us on 104.5 The Zone, talking Vols and Bowling Green ahead of tonight's game. At Adam Sparks is where you can follow him on social media. To the defensive side of the ball, we understand the attrition. We understand the depth concerns. I think the thing that stands out to me the most, Sparks, is I question their ability to get pressure. We know that they struggled to cover a great many ways last year, and their linebacking core is going to look significantly different and a bit depleted, understanding the kind of caliber players that they lost. But I think the defensive line is the biggest unknown to me. Am I incorrect in that assessment?
No, I think that's accurate. You're going to see you're going to see some 4-3 tonight. You're going to see some 4-2-5, more of a nickel look, which is what they want to be their base. Bowling Green will run two tight ends a bit, so that's why you're going to see the scheme be a little more 4-3 tonight. They're trying to find the pressure. And now when you ask the coaches, they will point out two or three guys that they hope can bring pressure, but it's always a hope, and it's always – the context behind it is always, well, we're looking for more. We're looking for more guys, which tells you in practice they still have not found that guy or those guys that can consistently bring pressure. You know, this secondary does have has some depth, has quite a bit of experience. I mean, they've got four or five guys that have started a ton of games back there. And, Willie Martinez, the secondary coach, was here back in the early Butch Jones days, and that's when UT had one of the better secondaries in the conference. They were really good in the secondary back then, but they had pressure back then. I think he can do the same thing with this secondary, again, with experience, but if you don't have pressure, it's not going to matter what happens on the back end. So they have to bring it tonight. Again, the theme here is if they can do it against Bowling Green, a bad team, there's a chance they could do it against others. If they can't bring pressure against Bowling Green, then I don't think they have much of a hope to do it against much better teams.
Right. Well, that was going to be kind of my next question. You know, given how bad Bowling Green was offensively last season, like, what can we really learn about this defense tonight other than if they struggle against a really bad Bowling Green offense? If things go well for the defense tonight, did we really learn anything? What's the number one thing that you're hoping to learn tonight?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's across the board, offense, defense, and everything, is that if anything goes poorly tonight, it's a red flag. If things go well, you can be optimistic, cautiously optimistic about whatever that thing is. Obviously this game is set up for, it's not going to be overreaction Sunday, I guess overreaction Friday. Because if UT's offense looks great and Joe Milton throws for 300 yards and they rush for 150 and, they get five sacks and a couple of picks and they win by 30 points, then, the thought tomorrow will be, okay, they're going to go beat Pitt by 14 and they're going to win, seven, eight games this year and everything's going to be fine. And you know what? And I kind of understand that. UT's had a tough last year. Or last 10 years, but especially the last year. And so they need some good vibes in this program. And I think they'll get them tonight. There's going to have to be some questions come out of this, but I think people are mostly looking for a hint of life on defense and really just to be entertained on the offensive side. I mean, Jeremy Pruitt's offense was, it was just grinding. Oh. It was hard to watch. This one's supposed to be the opposite.
Sparks, I swear, it's so reminiscent to me, and for all the time that you spent in Nashville, obviously covering Vanderbilt prior to this, you know the complaints about previous iterations of like the Titans offense, where it just so slow, so grinding, so difficult to watch, and when you're covering it, it's not like you can change the channel or go to Red Zone. You just got to sit there and suffer through it. So that's the thing that I'm most focused on. Adam Sparks of the Knoxville News Sentinel here with us on 104.5 The Zone, talking about the Vols. We'll get to Joe Milton here in just a second. Actually, let's talk about the quarterback. It's not necessarily a given that this is his job moving forward. But it is his job tonight, and assuming that he continues to perform well, he seems to be their preferred choice. What do you need to, outside of winning, obviously, what do you need to see specifically from Joe Milton to make you further your belief that he is the right choice for this team?
Well, I mean, he's got to run the offense efficiently, and that means it's got to be fast. Josh Heupel believes, especially in his offense, if you can't run it fast, you shouldn't be on the field. And he believes Joe Milton can do that, process a whole lot of information, stay on the field. I mean, it's as up-tempo as they are, it can be somewhat of an equalizer. It keeps the defense from subbing, obviously. You get to attack a whole lot more. If Milton can do that, they'll stick with him. I mean, he's got some other things where, you know, he overthrows short throws, throws them too hard, inconsistent somewhat in his deep throws, although he's got a cannon for an arm. You know, there's some things that are that either may be fixable in the throwing game, but he's got to be able to run the offense efficiently. It's, you know, I'm going to be interested to see who the number two comes out.
I was just going to say, do we have any idea?
No, I mean, it's Harrison Bailey or Hendon Hooker, and there's really, I mean, there's so much on that storyline, because Hendon Hooker, Virginia Tech transfer, came here thinking he was the choice by Jeremy Pruitt. Jeremy Pruitt leaves, and he's either two or number three now, and his eligibility is limited. Harrison Bailey's a sophomore and thought this would be his job. Again, with Pruitt, he's got a lot of eligibility left, and so, you know, I think Hooker looks at it and says, you know, I need to go somewhere else if I'm going to play at all. Unless he's the number two tonight, then he says, hey, if Milton struggles, I'm the next guy. I'm going to get my chance this year. And Bailey has to look at it and say, either Milton's going to be a bust and it's my job. This is if Bailey's number two. Or Milton's going to be great. He's going to be in the NFL next year, and it's my job next season. So there's a possibility for either one of those. But again, if you're the number three, then there's really no future for you here. And I think that's why they listed those two guys as an or. If it's a blowout, at least two guys will play. Tennessee Tech's in 2 weeks. That'll be a blowout. At least two guys will play. If you're the third guy not playing, you know, I don't think you have much of a future here.
Yeah, I think ultimately, and that's that, the backup situation is going to be a curiosity for a great many reasons, but I think ultimately, just as far as Joe Milton and the offense goes, I think Vols fans, Sparks, are just looking for a product that they have been sold on as is. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if I said that correctly, but like with Jeremy Pruitt, they never became what they said they were going to be, right? That was where the frills kind of came off this thing, and they've had so much time to hear about Josh Heupel's offense and to hear about the system that he runs and to see, you know, what he was able to do at UCF and understand what that may look like in Knoxville. I think they just want to be able to actually buy a product that they're being sold.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I mean, I think the best case scenario for this team this year is Ole Miss last year. You know, Lane Kiffin brought an offense there. He did inherit some skill position guys, more so than Heupel has here. But, you know, that team last year with Ole Miss could put up 40 on anybody. Sometimes they'd win 45-38. Sometimes they'd lose, you know, 55-42. But you went away from the game saying, I was entertained. We had a chance. It was fun. And they won 500. They went 500 in SEC play. If UT can, you know, win 6-7 games and put up 30-plus in most of those games, there's some hope there. Because you could say, hey, this offense is going to be good every year, almost every game. Now you just got to fix the defense. There's hope in that. I think UT fans just want to be able to know when they go to Neyland, they're going to see one thing for certain, and that would be offense.
Adam, I agree with you there, but I also wonder how much of that is Lane Kiffin and the charisma he kind of brings as a head coach. Because when you go back to 2012, I think Vols fans look back at that as a record-breaking season on offense with Justin Hunter, Cordarrelle Patterson, Tyler Bray at quarterback. But the defense was record-breaking in the opposite direction, and they were losing games 50-45 in a 5-7 season. And I don't remember many positive thoughts after that year. So I agree with you, but I wonder how much of that has to do with Lane Kiffin in terms of the positive vibes around Ole Miss, because Tennessee fans remember
happening. I think if you want to go back a number of years, I think the standard or the hope is also is a little lower now. I mean, this team was 3-7 last year. It was hard to watch. There's an NCAA investigation. Everything that Pruitt had was boring. And, you know, you can go back so many years and, you know, UT fans were not happy with 9-4. You fast forward now and a bowl game and fun games are enough for this year. And now the obvious, if you want to go to Lane Kiffin again from last year at Ole Miss, is that he had a quarterback. He actually had two of them, but Matt Corral's a Heisman Trophy candidate this year. If Joe Milton a year from now is what Matt Corral is right now, then UT fans are going to be excited and they're going to have what they were sold. But that's, you know, Joe Milton is obviously the one there that you need to make that leap with.
We're talking about Joe Milton next year, and they got to play Bowling Green first. Exciting stuff, but always a pleasure to catch up with our friend and be informed by our friend Adam Sparks of the Knoxville News Sentinel. Make sure you subscribe to the Knoxville News Sentinel. Well worth your subscription to support the great journalism that they are doing over there on your favorite sports teams. Buddy, enjoy the game tonight, and I'm sure we'll catch up again soon.
All right, guys. Y'all have a good one.
Okay. 615-737-1045 is the number. What is your reaction to what he had to say? Are you buying what the Vols are selling right now? Joey will lead us off on the other side. If you want to jump in, you're more than welcome to do so, because it's basically all Vols the rest of the way here. I'm Buck Rising. This is 104.5 The Zone.
Friday night, it's Beach at Hendersonville in the 104.5 The Zone football Friday night game of the week. Presented by the Tennessee Highway Safety Office and Paul Winkler Investing. Coverage starts Friday night at 6 with Will Bowling and Lucas Panzica on your home for high school football. 104.5 The Zone.
you are more than welcome to do so. 615-737-1045. Let's go to Joey in Kentucky, who's been waiting very patiently and wants to weigh in on the Vols tonight. What's up, Joey?
Oh, nothing, man. How y'all doing?
We're great.
Good, good. No, it was a good question earlier, you know, what people were looking for and that type of thing as far as with the Vols game. You know, I know who's playing quarterback, who's playing running back, offensive line coach, that's all important. But as far as I'm concerned, I don't care whose name's on the back of that jersey. All that's important to me is that you got these young men running out in orange, and most importantly, it's football time in Tennessee, baby!
Was that a walk-off? Thank you, Joey. He waited 15 minutes to do that.
I appreciate it.
I do, too. Listen, I love the energy. 615-737-1045. It is indeed football time in Tennessee. Things you love to see. 615-737-1045. You know, it is so exciting to have this, and particularly here at 104.5 The Zone, because I was watching, or I was scrolling Twitter yesterday, and we're going to talk about Jurrell Casey's retirement. I'm gonna make the best effort that I can to get over to his retirement press conference at Nissan Stadium later this afternoon. But we were talking about this today. I had noticed that the Vols put out a hype video last night. If you want to jump in on the conversation, 615-737-1045. But the hype video that they put out last night, the VFL Films, is exceptional quality. I don't know if it's quite to the production level of LSU, but it does impress me every time I see something that's put out. So I'm scrolling and I see, a Vols hype video. So I'm like, all right, you have earned my business as a scroller, that anytime I see you produce something, I'm probably going to stop and click on it. And then I notice that it has the customary hype around it, and the thing starts, and then it says voiced by Ramon Foster, VFL. And it made me smile. So I said, of course, I would love to listen to this hype video voiced by Ramon Foster about the University of Tennessee.
A century. A lot can happen in 100 years. Thousands of moments, millions of fans. This stadium has transformed from an empty field to a fear cathedral. It's where past and present converge.
Here come the Volunteers.
It's where moments are turned into memories.
Everything is riding on this football game. He's dropped on a sack by Reggie White. Touchdown, Big Allen, in the down four.
We're going to give it to Camara. First to the 10, the 5, the Sugar Bowls. Touchdown, Tennessee.
A very, very special time as across the way, the Volunteers come racing onto the field. What time is it? You know. As Tennessee comes barreling out onto the greensward, it's football time in Tennessee.
Now, a new century of opportunity is here. And it all begins now.
Here we go, man. Let's go! Gotta win today! Let's go! Sun's out in Knoxville! Woo-hoo-hoo! It's a big boy kind of day today!
Right, there's a standard in anything and everything that we're doing. We meet the standard. Everybody got me? We in it to win it, ain't that right, huh? We have to learn how to have a winning mentality. It's freaking winning time. Nothing else matters.
Ooh, goosebumps. VFL Films, voiced by Ramon Foster. Does that get the people going?
That is produced by my old sweet mate, Isaac Fowler, who does an amazing job over there.
Oh, very nice. So you're hitting all the notes, right? You're hearing John Ward. You start to feel the tingle in the back of your spine. It gets the people going. But I was quick to remind Lucas, because he pointed this out to me today, and he said, we should play this on the show. And I said, of course we will, because we're supportive of Ramon, and we want all of the Vols fans to enjoy their game day atmosphere. And that gets you fired up. We'll get to your phones your phone calls here in just a second. 615-737-1045. But I was quick to remind Lucas that the last time one of our friends voiced a hype video for their alma mater, it was Will Compton and the University of Nebraska. And things did not go well for the University of Nebraska in week zero. Just saying. 615-737-1045. Bill is in Lebanon. He wants to talk about the Vols. I had to do it. What's up, Bill?
Hey, Buck. How you doing?
I'm great, buddy.
I'm looking for competence.
Okay.
Like Georgia State, I just want to see them be prepared to play tonight. Fundamentals, good tackling, know what they're doing, no stupid penalties, play hard. That's what I'm looking for. I don't care about the score unless they lose.
Yeah. But, there is
I
want
to see them come out and play hard, hit somebody in the mouth, and look like they know what they're doing and play with confidence. That's all I think anybody's looking for. And, you know, the offensive line should dominate. I want to see them dominate and just bury people play after play. And then we can talk about Pitt and maybe go 2-0. So, hey, here we go.
Hey, I appreciate the call, Bill. And I think that's the baseline, right? This is where I'm kind of approaching this particular game. I am looking for the exact same things that Bill just outlined. I want to see you be able to execute against an inferior team. I understand that this is the first game for a new coaching staff with a new quarterback and a lot of new pieces both on both sides of the ball, right? That being said, you are a 35-point favorite. This is a team, and we'll get it. Lucas has some incredible stats that he spent time researching last night about Bowling Green, and I have some of my own that we will get to the people here in just a second with some exceptional radio production, because that's what we do around here. But 35-point favorite, the University of Tennessee at home against a clearly inferior team. 615-737-1045. I don't want the excuses of this was the first time out, even as I understand that it is. I need to see you wrap up and make tackles against players who are going to be physically smaller and less impressive than you are as an SEC athlete. I need to see that the quarterback has command at the line of scrimmage. Now, how much he, you know, it varies as to how much he's allowed to do at the line of scrimmage and whether they're just asking him to walk up there, execute the play, and move on with the next one because they're going to be moving at tempo. We know that is a staple of Heupel's offense and something that they demand. But you cannot play with tempo if you cannot execute from the jump. So everything hinges on them being able to get comfortable and them being able to do these things that seem so simple, so basic, but that lacked from this University of Tennessee team a year ago. 615-737-1045. Let's go to Dirty Bird, who's in the borough, wants to weigh in on the Vols. What's up, Dirty Bird?
Well, first, I want to wish you guys a good season. I hope everything works out for y'all. I'm not a Tennessee fan. I just have a question.
Okay.
And I wanted you guys' opinion on it. The Clemson-Georgia game, do you know who the Clemson quarterback is? And number two, do you think Georgia can beat them? And I'll hang up and listen.
I do know who the Clemson quarterback is. It's DJ Uiagalelei.
Uiagalelei.
Nailed it. Rack 'em.
I practiced it a few times last night, too.
Where's the bell?
Oh, sorry.
Every time. It's now we have to do it this way. Unbelievable. Yeah, DJ Uiagalelei is the quarterback for Clemson tonight. I do think they're capable of beating Georgia. I do think that, I mean, listen, both teams are capable of beating one another when they play this weekend. And I'm really fascinated to see, you know, just talking about the larger slate of college football as a whole, I'm fascinated to see Ohio State's new quarterback tonight. I mean, a lot of new quarterbacks at some serious, I mean, well, DJ's not new, but he is somebody who has very limited experience when Trevor Lawrence was dealing with the COVID list. Yeah, I do think they're capable of beating Georgia. And in fact, I do, if I was, and I'll probably check the line out later. I haven't looked at the betting lines yet on that game. I would probably, if I'm just looking at this, I would take Clemson straight up. But I believe in Clemson's depth right now more than I believe in Georgia's. Not to say that Georgia isn't hugely talented from top to bottom. It's just Clemson always has those returning guys that kind of set you over the edge. We'll continue with your phone calls. What are you most looking forward to tonight? What are you concerned about with the University of Tennessee? You can have an opinion on both sides, even as we celebrate UT football today, opening day. More on the other side coming up next, and we'll tell you some ridiculous stats about your opponent, Bowling Green. Coming up next, I'm Buck Rising. This is 104.5 The Zone.
Jason Martin and Ramon Foster might have the mics, but the show is about you, the fam.
You guys are the show. We have some microphones. That means you can hear us. We want to hear you. We want to know you. You guys are just like us. Just like us. We might be in a different position in terms of our voice can be heard by more people. You know what else it doesn't mean? It doesn't mean that your voice doesn't matter. It doesn't mean that that ours matters any more than yours does. We just love you guys.
J. Martin Ramon, tomorrow, starting at 6 on 104.5 The Zone.
call in to just say how excited I am to watch my little cousin, Princeton Fant, play for the Vols on tonight. Princeton Fant, he's also cousin of the tight end for the Broncos, Noah Fant. And so I'm just really excited. I'm glad that there was a coaching change from last year. They really didn't use their tight ends in the passing game, and that's really what the Vols recruited him for. He was a wide receiver at Laverne High School, but when he got to the Vols, he went from wide receiver to running back to now a tight end, and he's a huge, huge tight end. That dude is so big, but I'm excited to watch him play tonight.
Hey, I appreciate the call, Brandon. Enjoy the game, and best of luck to your to both of your cousins on the football field this fall. Did you have something to say, Lucas?
Yeah, I did want to ask him about the story this past offseason of Princeton finding out Noah was his cousin.
Oh, you didn't want me to hang up on him?
That's okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, the Princeton Fant, Laverne, Tennessee zone, they tried to put him at running back?
He's
225.
Well, I've lost track of the positions they tried to put him at.
My God.
I think it was more of a fullback role.
I was going to say, like, that's like Derrick Henry size running down the field. But, yeah, I think there's a lot of excitement about these skill position players. I mean, more than anything, and if you want to jump in, 615-737-1045. We'll get to the lines have been loaded all day long, so we'll get to as many as humanly possible to make sure that we get you the game day energy that you're trying to carry on these airwaves until kickoff tonight at 7 p.m. You know, I think the skill position players for the Vols are really interesting. I think that specifically for me, Jalen Hyatt, and really these wide receivers in general, I think Jalen Hyatt as a freshman, you know, nothing really, if you're just looking at like box scores, statistics, and things like that, 20 catches, 276 yards, 2 touchdowns, but he certainly flashed playmaking ability. And then simply the freshman class on the whole last year was really underutilized, I thought, by Pruitt and the staff, which is, you know, among the many things that were underutilized by Jeremy Pruitt at the University of Tennessee. I think in Heupel's offense, I mean, he could very well be the centerpiece, right? He's probably the most talented player. He's probably got the most upside of any skill position player on this roster. Am I incorrect in saying that, Lucas?
No, I would agree with that. I think he's got the potential to benefit from this offense more than any other player on this roster.
He's probably, outside of the quarterback and let's say Cade Mays, just as the best offensive lineman, he's probably the most critical piece to that side of the ball.
Yeah, just because of the future. The future that you could have at that position with him.
Right. Listen, if they can manufacture exciting offense, I'm all in. I want to see Jalen Hyatt eat in this offense with Josh Heupel. 615-737-1045. Austin is in Clarksville. He wants to talk about the Vols. What's up, Austin?
Hey, man. I just want to see tonight, see what you said this offense is going to do. You know, past couple of years, a little stagnant. Old 90s style football, it's hard to watch. But, yeah, I'm looking forward to the game tonight. It's on the SEC Network tonight, which means I have to buy ESPN Plus, but I guess I'll just use that as a tax write-off, you know. I just want to get that in there. I'll holler at you later.
Did you listen
well
to us?
Well played.
Did you listen to Bustin' with the Boys?
I got a good chunk of it, yeah.
All right. So now I have to explain the joke because it's a funny joke, but you have to both be a listener. And many people are. Many people are saying this. Many people are listeners of our radio show and Bustin' with the Boys. Of course, I was on this week's episode of Bustin' with the Boys. And we were talking about Jake Paul and Tyron Woodley, the fight over the weekend. And I said that the only reason that I bought it is because for me, things like that are a tax write-off because of what we do for a living. And for, you know, Lucas, and I said that on the podcast, and both Will Compton and Darren Bates looked at me like that's the weirdest damn flex that anybody has ever had. What are you broke? You need the tax write-off from a pay-per-view fight?
Still not a good enough excuse for watching that fight.
No, well, I mean, I'm getting content out of it, so I can't outright dismiss it. And there's a market for it, but I'm not gonna spiral down this wormhole again. There's too much football to discuss today. All I will say is that was a well-played joke by Austin, yes. And I appreciate it. I appreciate him listening to both the radio show and Bustin' with the Boys.
Well, for what it's worth, you do not have to pay for the game tonight. It's on regular SEC Network.
Yeah, so he does, because that doesn't make sense to me either. It's on, like, just, well, if you don't have, like, the expanded sports package, then you have to pay for the expanded sports package. Like, you can't just get it if you're watching, if you're somebody who just pays for basic cable with ESPN and ESPN2, right? That's the only thing that comes standard anymore?
Yeah, I guess so. I don't know. At this point, I have no idea how cable works.
Do you pay for cable?
No.
No?
I do Hulu.
Okay. Well, again, this is one of those things where, you know, weird flex, but I have a cable package, which is stupid. There's no reason for me to have a cable package.
Tax write-off.
It is a tax write-off, but I live alone, and I'm not home on Sundays to watch football. Like, Saturdays, it works, but a lot of times, you know, Saturday is the one day of the week that I get to not do the sports thing, so I'm not always locked on the TV outside of Tennessee, because that's obviously the thing that we're going to talk about the most here in Nashville and with the talk show. But I think that more than anything, a lot of people our age don't necessarily go with the cable package. 615-737-1045. Let's go to Antoine, who's in East Nashville. He wants to talk about UT today. What's up, Antoine?
Mr. Buck, Mr. Benziger, I'm showing credit to you guys for doing a great job.
Appreciate it.
Just an opinion, man. I hope your people don't kill me for this. But growing up where I grew up at and how I grew up, UT and a lot of colleges, they're considered like plantations to us. And when we hear Tennessee football, just from the encounters of people that we have, it's like a 1% of people like us that we see that play football and actually prevail past that. But then actually just looking at it, it's like there's nothing exciting about it. There's nothing that draws us to it. It just seemed like when I see college football, it's like a bunch of pawns. And the people that control the NCAA, is like they're using all these players as checker pieces chess pieces, and they're just playing here and there. I don't get the same type of excitement as watching college football as I do watching professional football. It's like the passion, the drive, and it maybe it'll change now with the NIL.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, does that change anything for you with NIL? Because, Antoine, I'm sure you speak for a lot of people. Absolutely.
Yes.
So what I'm saying, does NIL change anything for you in this regard, or is it just too early?
So to a degree, yes. So now it's like a breath of like saying, finally.
Yeah.
But then it's the stigmatism that I have when I see people like Dabo Swinney. So pure collar bred white American, and that's the way it should go. Why do I not see enough black coaches in that position with that type of power of a Dabo Swinney? Like how it was back for HBCUs back then when everyone had a crazy nickname, but you knew they could play football.
Yeah. No, hey, I appreciate the call, Antoine. Thank you. Because I'm sure you're not alone in that, and not everybody is willing to express that opinion on when everybody else is celebrating college football. You know, there's people like Antoine that feel that kind of way. I mean, for different reasons, I felt that way about last year's college football season. And listen, the injustice, not to completely pivot into my stance on college athletics, because I know you guys know how I feel about this, where the injustice is such that they're still not getting paid off the television dollars. Everybody realizes that, right? Like the NIL stuff is just the NCAA allowing companies to cover the cost of the athlete compensation in a way that they don't have their bottom line affected by the TV dollars, but you know, your local Ford dealership can come in and start to pay the athletes to where at least they feel like it's a little more even. This is not even remotely even, but again, you know, that gets swept up as soon as people run out of the power T for the vast majority of folks, I do feel like. So I'd be curious, because there is that kind of skepticism isn't right, but you're looking at it and it doesn't evoke the same joy in you as it does the vast majority of people, because you understand, people like Antoine understand just how wrong it has been for those athletes in this position for so long. But, you know, Rocky Top and all
that. It's a start.
But, again, it's nowhere close, and it's taken us this long to get just the start. Anyway, we'll come back and we'll give you some ridiculous stats. Let's laugh a little bit. That brought us back down. Listen, it's like football. Don't get too high, don't get too low. We've had highs, and we can continue to have highs, and we can have lows. today as well. We'll tell you what we're most looking forward to tonight from this University of Tennessee team, where our concerns lie, and some ridiculous stats about Bowling Green that are going to make you laugh out loud with how bad they are at football. All that and more coming up next. I'm Buck Rising. This is 104.5 The Zone.
Jurrell Casey, not too shabby for a third-round pick in the 2011 draft.
Bortles steps up. Bortles hit. Bortles sacked! Jurrell Casey!
We salute the career of Jurrell Casey, number 99, from Titans Radio and 104.5 The Zone.
Sean Picklesheimer, I think is how I say it. Anyway, Sean on Twitter has tweeted us and said, hold up, Buck Rising, did that dude really say there's more passion in the NFL than college? No, he just said that he is more passionate about the NFL than in college. I mean, that's something that's – that here's where my kind of perspective lacks on this, right? Because I – the only college football game that I've ever been to are the Vandy games. And I'm working like Vandy games in the last – I mean, I haven't been to a Vandy game in probably 2 years because I used to work the home games.
And not the greatest indication of SEC fanhood.
Well, I would say that's an accurate representation. But I don't know, you know? I don't know because I didn't go to college football games in college. Right, we went to the tailgates at Indiana. They have miles upon miles of tailgate fields for you to, you know, black out and pass out in a porta potty with. But nobody ever went into the games. So I have zero context for what like a real live college football atmosphere should be, which is why I'm dying to go to a game at Neyland Stadium. I'd love to go because I want a college football experience. It's probably why. You know, I just didn't grow up super passionate about it because that's not what we did. I mean, there are Notre Dame football fans in Indiana. There's Notre Dame football fans all over the place. But, like, South Bend is literally at the top of the state, and Evansville, where I'm from, is all the way at the bottom. So, and even, you know, it's not like I spent my entire life in Indiana. You know, we lived in New York City, not a great tradition of college football there. We lived in Washington, D.C., not a great tradition of college football. Great tradition of college football there. You know, Cairo, Egypt, I don't think there's football, but not football. You know what I'm saying? So not something that I have the context for. So I'm dying to see a college football game at Neyland. And I think that when the Titans play on Monday Night Football, maybe Lucas and, well, I don't know if Lucas wants to go with me. It sounds like he's made his own plans and not invited me, but that's okay. I forgive him. 615-737-1045. What are you most excited to see tonight with the University of Tennessee? We've talked about the offense. We've talked about the quarterback. We've talked about just playing sound, fundamental football. And I think that's the baseline to where we will start. We've also spent some time on the skill position players as well. And we will continue to talk about those skill position players with Joey Kent, who will join us at 12:20. But before Lucas and I let you know, Lucas has some ridiculous Bowling Green football stats. And I want to tell you what I'm looking forward to and what I'm most concerned about, not tonight specifically, but just kind of larger themes heading into the season. Let's go to the phones. Let's get Mitchell, who's in Nashville, who wants to weigh in. And Lucas tells me that he's on the way to Knoxville. What's up, Mitchell? Mitchell, you're on the air.
How's it going, Buck? We got a ticket with your name on it.
Oh, yeah? What, for tonight?
Yep, tonight.
Well, listen, buddy, I got stuff I got to do tonight. I can't show up in Knoxville and then drive back to Nashville for a radio show tomorrow.
Oh, come on, Buck. Unless you want to.
Okay. Listen, I'm dying to go. I would love.
Hey, we got two tickets. Hire you a driver.
Hire me a driver. Yeah. With a.
I know those IU games weren't living up to Knoxville.
Buddy, I never went into the stadium. The only time I went into Indiana football stadium was for graduation. And the only reason we were in the stadium for graduation is because Assembly Hall, the basketball stadium, was under construction. I literally never went in. You know what I'm saying? So, like, I want the college football experience. And you're being generous in providing me one, but you know I can't come on a weeknight. Come on now.
Yeah, no, it's a weeknight. Too late for you, but listen,
I'm getting old. Well, I don't have to do the primetime show tonight, so I got a free night. But thank you for the offer, Mitchell. Enjoy the game.
Yeah, you're welcome.
615-737-1045. Should I just go with a random like fan?
Yeah, I mean, get the experience. Like, I can't. I think I speak for a lot of people too. I cannot fathom a college experience without college football. I can't because for months in the fall, literally your entire week revolves around that Saturday game.
Nah.
I mean, it determines your happiness for the week. I mean, seriously.
That's basketball in Indiana, except it's worse because they play multiple games a week, and so you have plenty of time to suffer, even as you might.
Right, well, that's what makes it special. There's only 12 games, 7 or 8 home games, and the tailgating on a Saturday every time. I mean, I just cannot fathom the college experience without it.
So I had the tailgating. Like, tailgates are a staple, right? Like, you go to... Yeah, not that anybody would have the context for this, but you go to Kilroy's for a breakfast club, you're blacked out drunk by 6 a.m., Then you go tailgate for an 11 o'clock kickoff, or I guess a noon kickoff on Eastern time. And then you don't go to the game. You go home and you watch the SEC. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, there was excitement when I was on campus about a football game one time, and that was Urban Meyer's first year at Ohio State when they were still on, I don't think it was like probation, but like they weren't bowl eligible, but I think they still ended up going undefeated that year. And like Indiana almost got them. They lost by a field goal in that game. So I know that people were excited about it. I know that people went to see that game, but I think it was a lot of Ohio State fans that went, that traveled to Bloomington and went, took over Indiana Stadium. And now they're like good at football. So I don't know what it may be that people actually go to the games now. But, you know, what is it? 6 years ago when I was in college, people didn't give a damn about the football games. You went to the bar, you went to the tailgate fields, you went home to watch the rest of the slate in college football that Saturday. 615-737-1045. I want to get to Darrington and Juan here in a second. And, of course, we'll get back to your phone calls. But I want to make sure that we talk about this from our standpoint, because from my perspective, and we spent some time with this with Adam Sparks of the Tennessean earlier, where we're talking about, you know, for me, I'm looking at this and I'm rooting for the Vols tonight, right? When the Vols are good, our job is more fun. And because I have no college football team, I have zero rooting interest, so why not declare myself for the Tennessee Vols and the Vanderbilt Commodores and all of the local sports teams except for the one that I cover, because that's not what I do. So I'm down, you know, to get behind this thing. But I'm a tough sell. Tennessee baseball, for those of you watching on Zone TV and that can see my villain shirt today, they had to sell me on this thing. They had to go to the College World Series. And maybe that's, you know, maybe that just makes me a bandwagon.
Well, Vitello won you over on that one.
Well, yeah, Tony V's a stud.
You're smitten.
I am.
It's hard not to be.
Aren't we all? That man. But, yeah, so, yeah, okay. So maybe I'm not a tough sell. Maybe it just takes one appearance by the coach and that he's fun to talk to. And I'm like, oh, okay, I'm a Tennessee baseball fan. That's it. But from this standpoint, you know, I want to buy what the Vols are selling me, because what the Vols are selling me is something that I desperately crave. It's why Titans fans for the longest, when I first got to town, hated me. Because I would rip the Titans up and down because I hated to watch them play. I was paid to cover their team, and I hated to watch them play because of the style of play that they had. Even like the first DeMarco Murray year, where the running game was right and Marcus Mariota was healthy and they made the postseason and all of that, like there were some exciting moments. But for the most part, you know, I'm looking at games where it's field goals, not touchdowns, and it's 3 yards in a cloud of dust, like 1980s football, and I don't care about that. I want Patrick Mahomes. I want Tom Brady. I want 35 touchdowns a season, and what I'm getting, you know, is a quarterback that's barely scratching 20 and, you know, exotic smash-mouth football. I don't care about that. Get out of here. Make your games fun for me to watch. So that's what I'm looking to buy that, because the Vols are trying to sell it to me. Josh Heupel, Danny White, they're trying to sell this to me. And I'm in the market. But you've got to prove it to me against a team that you're favored over by 35 damn points. 615-737-1045. What are you most excited to see from the Vols tonight? Lucas, how are you feeling about your football team?
Well, I think you can lose a lot more than you can gain with a game like tonight, but you know, you should expect it's dangerous to go out and expect a certain score margin, but you just want to see the speed, you want to see the tempo offensively, and to be honest, you want to see this defense completely shut down Bowling Green. If there's any struggles there early on, that could really set the tone for what could be a long season.
So what kind of struggles are we talking about? Are we talking about like third down? Are we talking red zone? Like what specifically? Give me something.
I'm looking at the pass rush, because this is a team that had 20 sacks last season, compared to a Pitt team that's coming to Knoxville in week two that was third in the ACC with 46 sacks in 10 games last season, Rashad Weaver. And Tennessee had less than half of that. And a lot of those came early on with a guy like DeAndre Jordan, who's now, or DeAndre Johnson, Jordan, I can't even remember at this
point. DeAndre Jordan is a center for, or he was a center. I don't know if he's still in the league right now.
DeAndre Johnson, who's now at Miami, racking up, you know, 4.5 sacks in the first 2-3 games of the season. So it was kind of front-loaded.
Do you know, I immediately just got a headache when you said that the Vols had 20 sacks last year in 10 games, and the Titans had 19 in 16 games?
Yeah, man. Yeah, that really puts that into context.
There it is.
But Byron Young, a guy that this staff has raved about, came in, JUCO transfer all offseason. You want to see him, Tyler Barron, see if he'll take the next step. So defensively, that's really where I'm looking.
Lebowski says, Lebowski in the chat on YouTube says, as an MTSU fan, I sympathize, Buck. No game day hype, just alcohol consumption. I'm going to go, by the way, I'm going to MTSU's game against Monmouth. I've never been to Murfreesboro. Well, I've been physically through Murfreesboro. I've never gotten out of the car in Murfreesboro. So I will do that on Saturday. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm going to take advantage of the long weekend. I'm going to see the local sites. And one of them just happens to be MTSU, because we're going to have Coach Rick Stock still on next week. And I'm looking up to you. I'm looking forward to catching up with Stock. All right. So we have stats about Bowling Green. We're going to get to the phones here in just a second. Juan, Darrington, Danny, hang tight. Lucas, you texted me last night. You said you have done research, which I'm glad that it took game day for your team for you to do research before the show. Thank you for putting such extensive effort,
my heart and soul,
into this particular endeavor. Yes, I know, as you were when you came into the work wearing a Ramon Foster's 1988 Vols helmet today, or 2008, or wherever the hell. So you've compiled some hilarious Bowling Green stats from last season. Now it is time for you to provide the people with said hilarious stats.
Learn more than I ever would care to know about the Bowling Green Falcons last night. This is a program that has not won more than 4 games since Dino Babers was the head coach in 2015, before he moved on to Syracuse. One of the worst teams in college football last season. If it's not for UMass, they were certainly the worst team in college football last season. 5 games, they were 0-5. And this is not losses where you're traveling to Power 5 programs for a big paycheck. Their schedule was Toledo, Kent State, Buffalo, yeah, Ohio, Akron. They did not lose a game by less than 25 points. Returned 3 starters in the secondary, so that's the good news. But they did not record a single interception last season. That's the bad news. Good news, they gave up only 165 pass yards per game last season. Bad news is that's because they were giving up 310 rush yards per game last season. Again, 310 rush yards per game last season. Boston College transfer Matt McDonald is their quarterback, as a caller mentioned previously, the only returning starter on the offense. 1 touchdown, 6 interceptions in 2020. And what little receiving production they had last year, they lost. They did bring in a transfer from Washington in Tyrone Broden. I know nothing about him. Starting a true freshman at center. And the kicker at the end, the Vols have not beaten a Group of 5 team by more than 24 points since the Bowling Green Falcons in 2015 in Nissan Stadium, a 59-30 final. Alvin Kamara's debut game.
With all of the incredible, the window, Lebowski says the Windows 3.0 startup sound kills me.
Keep it simple.
I swear to God, this is an incredible array of stats, because I also took some notes about Bowling Green, because you said that they were hugely inept, so I had to do some research myself. And I had the 0-5 last year in the pandemic shortened season. I had that they lost every game by at least 25 points last year. I had that they gave up an average of 310 yards per game on the ground alone, as we talked about. I had that they lost their 2 best defensive linemen to the transfer portal, and they offensively averaged, did you have this?
No, go ahead.
11 points per game.
Amazing.
It's so bad.
Scott Loeffler, their head coach, a former Urban Meyer assistant at Florida. He was their quarterbacks coach, I think, 2009. So around that Tim Tebow era, used to be the offensive coordinator at Auburn, but has created a wretched culture at Bowling Green, it seems.
You can't give me that sound enough.
They're really bad.
Did you also have that their leading wide receiver caught 6 passes for 97 yards last year?
Oh, my God. No, that's insane. Oh, to score 1 passing touchdown through 5 games is amazing. I mean, that's incredible.
Well, it sounds like we're mocking Bowling Green, because we are.
Well, it sounds like we're making these up, and we're not.
No, my God. Well, here's the thing. Like, I bet Bowling Green plus 35. Okay, I did, because that's an outrageous spread even for a team as bad at football as Bowling Green. But you know what else this makes me think of? It makes me think of the people who are complaining and opining about the world of college football changing, right? With the super conference that has now been created, or will be created, with Texas and Oklahoma coming to the SEC, and people worrying about squeezing out the little guy. Somebody tell me that, based off that, you know, 10 plus stats that we just gave you, if Bowling Green, for the sake of their players, should be playing college football, and you're not worried about squeezing out the little guy. No, thank you. 615-737-1045. Let's go to Darrington, who's been waiting patiently to weigh in. What's up, Darrington? How are we feeling today?
Coach, he's off the COVID list and ready to get active, Coach.
Whoa, okay. There's a little more. Yeah, there it is.
Hey, boy, I love that Hooked on Phonics sign. But for the ones who had trouble reading Hooked on Phonics, that was the sound you got when you got some words completed.
There
I remember. And I want to give a shout-out to Antoine, the caller earlier, because I agree. So my two takes is this, Buck. The best part about tonight's game is when it's going off. That's going to be the best part of it. I love it. Soon as the credits come on and they say game over, win, loss, that's the best part of college football, when it's over with. My second part, God. I heard Jurrell Casey's retired.
He is.
I heard when you stop eating meat, you can't play D. I'm out. Y'all have a good one, people.
Oh, so instead of congratulating Jurrell Casey on his retirement after 10 years in the league, he says you go vegan, you suck at football, is basically what he just said, which is not true, because Jurrell had his best season once he went completely plant-based. Wesley Woodyard the same, Derek Morgan the same. So that is factually incorrect.
Appreciate you though, Darrington.
And it's just, so he just assassinated the sport of college football. He just assassinated Jurrell Casey on what's supposed to be his day. By the way, I don't know, are you gonna carry that press conference on Blaine and Mickey?
Yes.
Okay, so that'll be at 1 o'clock.
Right off the top.
I don't know if we have we don't have a camera on Jonathan Schaefer right now. He's admiring Ramon Foster's 2008 football helmet. He's going to put it on. There's no way that your big ass head fits in that. Oh, look at that. What an upset. What an upset. I think with the mask under it, it looks like it's just one of these giant mouth guards now that they have the teeth in them. I think that's what exactly it looks like. So outstanding. Yeah, Ramon Foster brought in his helmet for show and tell day on game day, so everybody has taken turns wearing the helmet, which is strictly against the protocol.
I thought my head was big.
Yeah, well, we know your head is big.
Well, that helmet is too big for my big head.
Is it? Well, I mean, he's also, Ramon is what, 6'6"? 6'5"? Slay is what, 6'8"?
Yeah. God, sounds right.
6'7". Schaefer's just undercutting them by an inch every time.
6'7".
6'7". 6'5". I love it. Well, what do they say on J. Martin Ramon? Petty. We'll come back. We'll take your calls. Juan, Danny have been waiting patiently. We will talk about Jurrell Casey as well. If you'd like to remember Jurrell Casey, I mean, it's not like he's dead, but he's retiring today. So we'll do that coming up next. I'm Buck Rising. This is 104.5 The Zone.
Get Jason Martin and Ramon Foster on J-Mart and Ramon.
I'm about to go into work, but I got 2 points I want to make for you. And at the end of this, if you're not pumped for this, I don't know what to tell you, man.
Okay.
What all Vols fans are looking for tonight, we're looking to see if we can go in at halftime and not come out a completely different team and get blown out the rest of the game.
That's big.
We've been seeing that happen the past couple of years. Don't want to see that anymore. Want to come out and do better. The second point is, if you don't understand the fact that college football fans are rabid, baby. When everybody's wearing the same color, we're all in the same house. We're all cheering for the same goal. There's no politics involved. We're all yelling for the same thing. And if you win, it's that much better. You've never seen anything like it, baby. All that orange is going to wash over the state of Tennessee and make things better, even if it's just for a little day. You're going to go into work with your chest pumped out just a little bit bigger. You're going to feel a little bit taller at the end of those games. That's what we're looking for. We all need it. We all look forward to it every week, and there's nothing like it. Y'all have an amazing day.
Rack 'em. Hey, we got it. Thanks for the call, Juan. 615-737-1045. Juan's walking into work with his chest puffed, baby. He feels good about the University of Tennessee tonight. You should. They're a 35-point favorite.
Actually, Rick from Hendersonville just called in to let us know it's shifted to 36.5.
Whoa! Yeah. What happened?
I don't know. Bowling Green's just really bad.
It's a point and a half, though.
Yeah, I don't know. Nothing has come out for that point and a half shift.
Well, you know what's happened since then? We read all the stats on air, and Vegas got wind of them. They're like, oh, my God. They have a coin. Listen, the show is very powerful. They heard that the starting quarterback has one touchdown against six picks last year and completed 44% of his passes.
Ooh, let's bump that up a little. Yeah. But, no, really, though, there is something to be said for them just trying to go out and win a football game, because the Georgia State thing was not a game plan to beat Georgia State.
It was,
Let's try this out. Let's try this rotation on the offensive line. And then the fourth quarter came. It's like, oh, we're going to lose this game.
Yeah. Look at you, we.
I was putting myself in the staff meetings.
Okay. You sure? Did you intentionally not wear orange today?
Actually, to be honest, I didn't think about it. I usually don't when I decide what to wear. I should probably put more thought into it, but no.
Are you lying to me?
No.
I don't think I believe you. 615-737-1045. Danny is in Murfreesboro. He wants to talk about the balls. What's up, Danny?
Man, I couldn't tell if you guys were talking about Bishop Sycamore stats or Bowling Green stats.
Right.
Going through. That's rough, dude. That is rough. So, I've been in limbo as far as a college football fan for the past 6 or 7 years. I've been in Tennessee for 10 years, moved here from Ohio, and it just was not fun to be an Ohio State fan in Tennessee. So, I've just not really been paying much attention to college football until this year, and I really just decided that I'm throwing – all of my weight into being a Vols fan because I'm ready to be a part of something big. And just like Michael Scott, I'm ready to get hurt again, man. So as of this year, I am throwing all that I have into being a Tennessee Vol fan. I'm proud to be a part of the Klan. And I think that what I want to see most tonight is I want to see the pace of the offense, how many plays they're getting off in a series, how fast they're getting back to the line of scrimmage. I'm really excited to see the Josh Heupel offense and how fast it can be against a team like Bowling Green.
I agree with you, Danny. Thank you for the call. 615-737-1045. Heupel, listen, and by the way, you know, lost in all of this because it's actually here. We are finally at game day as a destination after, you know, Jeremy Pruitt being fired for cause, an NCAA investigation that, by the way, kickoff is in what? Not quite 7 hours. I tried to do math on there.
7 hours and 9 minutes.
I got scared. That's in just about 7 hours and change. You still don't know what the NCAA is going to do to you, which I find laugh out loud funny. Not for the purposes of the suffering of Tennessee fans, but just because it's a ridiculous thing that the NCAA is waiting up until a game is played or potentially after that to tell a school what their punishment may or may not be. I think that is so mind-numbingly stupid. But Heupel's, I don't know how often they're going to show on SEC Network tonight, how often they're going to show Josh Heupel on the sideline. But like Jeremy Pruitt's, and you can only take so much from a television broadcast about a coach's sideline behavior. But I do think you learned a lot about who Jeremy Pruitt actually was from watching him on the sideline. From the outburst with Jarrett Garantano after him improvising
Alabama
on the quarterback carry against Alabama, to, you know, the firing of a defensive line coach in game and something that you saw him clearly passionate about, to him looking like E.T. with the mask pulled up over his face.
The babushka.
Like a Ukrainian woman is going to market. This is a checkerboard, an orange checkerboard mask gator that he pulled up over his face like a tunnel. It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen in my life. So from that standpoint, you're watching the coach himself, because we know what Josh Heupel is. He's been in the sport long enough. Obviously, as a player of consequence, and then as a coach the last couple of years as a coordinator and as a head coach, you're wanting to learn more about how this man will conduct himself, how he handles in-game situations. Because it's not just a test for execution from the players on the field during this game. It is also a test of him and his coaching staff, Heupel and his coaching staff, to see how they manage in a big-time situation. This isn't Central Florida anymore, Dorothy. This is the University of Tennessee. You're going to have 102,000 people bearing down on your head the minute you make the wrong move. 615-737-1045. Babushka Pruitt. It's one of the highlights of last football season, if nothing else, for Vols fans. When we come back, we will talk about Jurrell Casey. We will talk about Jurrell Casey because he's going to retire at Nissan Stadium at 1 p.m. today. We will do that coming up next. Joey Kent, Vols wide receiver, will join us as well. And, you know, a Titan for a hot second. Joey Kent will talk about this University of Tennessee game with us in the noon hour. Stick around. It's 104.5 The Zone.
From preseason, regular season, and the playoffs, we got you covered.
Oh, oh, wow.
The Titan Station, 104.5 The Zone.
they most remember fondly during his years at the University of Tennessee. But we will enjoy our conversation with Joey, and we'll also talk about his new podcast, Three the Pro Way. 615-737-1045 is how you jump in on the conversation. We'll get to Dwayne and Franklin here in just a second, but I wanted to take a moment to talk about Jurrell Casey, because Jurrell Casey is retiring today as a Tennessee Titan. The press conference will be right after this radio show ends at 1 p.m. at Nissan Stadium. They're having it in the interview room. I guess they can't do things at the auditorium in the facility right now due to COVID protocols with the media. So we will all be there for that at the stadium, which is probably cool for Jurrell because I'm sure he hasn't been in it in a while since he left. So 10 years in the league, sputtering out there at the end with the Broncos, only played two games last year, but he had a great game against the Titans, batting down passes, causing problems for Tannehill. Like, he was still a high effort, high energy, high level player, even as his body started to fail him at the end. And as it did last year, to where he only made it through the two regular season games. We talked about the season opener against the Titans for the Broncos. And then the following game when he left with injury,
which is a credit to John Robinson, right?
Oh, I think that's the best thing. Like, re-signing Derrick Henry, re-signing Ryan Tannehill, all good. I think the most important thing that they did that year, that offseason, was get Jurrell Casey's contract off the
books. And people were pissed about it.
People are short-sighted. Like, I couldn't believe the amount of money he was making when I saw the contract. And Jurrell, deservedly so. He earned that money, but, like, I was shocked by his cap number. Like, oh my God, the fact that you got draft picks out of this, that you got somebody to assume the entirety of the contract, and this, you know, and then immediately John Elway the next year is taken out of the front office because people are like, what? What are you doing? But for Jurrell Casey, man, there are so many great memories I have of covering him, and none more so than, well, actually, the Blake Bortles thing was funny, but I don't think we have the audio of that. What we do have is Jurrell Casey before the 2019 AFC Championship game. They brought him to the press conference podium at the auditorium because, you know, Jurrell Casey deserves that kind of special treatment's not the right word, but you know what I'm saying. He has that kind of gravitas for this franchise after, at that point, spending 9 years. That would have been his ninth season with Tennessee, and these being the greatest heights that he was able to achieve in a Titans uniform. And to hear him talk about what that meant to him specifically. And then, of course, he was traded for parts after the season was over. But still, to hear him talk about this franchise at that moment, it really gave you a look at the humanity of this side of thing when football, the NFL, can be such a cold business. This was Jurrell Casey back in January of 2020.
I always said whenever I got drafted, I wanted to make sure I could, one, stay around on the team and be a leader. And then whenever I got opportunity, if I'm not in the Super Bowl, I didn't want to go nowhere. I wanted to stay with whatever team I'm with and make sure I lead that team to be a Super Bowl contender. And being a leader, that's what you got to do. And I take pride in that. And as you've seen with me not wanting to go to Pro Bowls, being alternates, it's just a mindset that I always had growing up is just, you know, when you stick with a team, it's loyalty. You know, you got to be with that squad. You got to ride with them. No matter how tough it is, you got to fight it out until I'm done. It's either I'm going to retire not being able to go to a Super Bowl at all with the Titans, or I was going to be able to go to one. My mindset, just take care of this AFC Championship and hope my dreams come true.
Now, obviously, neither of those dreams came true, and that's the harsh reality of the NFL. But I do think it's important to run back that audio because, always honest. Always honest in his dealings with us and his dealings with people and dealing with fans and with the organization, right? You're laying yourself pretty bare there. Now, so Jurrell Casey, and not to make this about me, but to kind of give myself a little bit of an attachment to him, my first day on the job covering the Titans, this was before A to Z Sports, this was before I worked for 104.5 The Zone, this was at the very, very start of my beginning, of my career. The first day I went to a practice, and at the time they had just renovated the practice facility. And I was told that it was a bit of a dump before that year. That would have been the 2016 season, if I recall correctly. So we're getting a tour of the new, of the revamped facility on that day from the PR staff. And all the entirety of the media corps there were taking pictures, you know, somebody screwing around on like a bench press bar or something like that, yada, yada, all that. And then all of a sudden, everybody's phones start going crazy. And we all look down at our phones, and Adam Schefter is breaking the news that Jurrell Casey, who's like three rooms over from us, has just signed a contract extension with the Tennessee Titans. I believe it was worth $60 million, if memory serves, or maybe $60 million guaranteed. I can't remember the figures off the top of my head, but that was my first day on the job getting dunked on as a local media corps by Adam Schefter because, you know, Drew Rosenhaus had just taken the picture of Jurrell Casey signing his contract with a thumbs up, texted it to Schefter. All us local media slaps are taking a tour of the weight room. And then Jurrell, in what was probably, it's not, I don't know that it was his finest moment because he had so many. I mean, we're talking about a player for this franchise that was largely godforsaken outside of the last 5 years. We're talking about a player, five-time Pro Bowl selection, didn't want to go to the Pro Bowl because he just didn't believe in the Pro Bowl as an institution. Six-time defensive captain, two-time Walter Payton NFL Man of the Year, seventh in franchise history with 51 sacks. He trails Javon Curse, the Freak, with 52.
And so second in the Titans era.
Correct. The greatness of Jurrell was not just encapsulated in this one moment, but probably his best moment in a game that had the greatest impact of his career was this 2019, or I guess technically 2020, strip sack of Lamar Jackson that ultimately helped clinch the AFC divisional round to send them to the AFC title game.
Backfield from his 25. Blitz coming. Jackson under pressure. Grabbed, hit, fumbles. Ball is loose. There's a fight for it. Simmons is at the bottom of the pile fighting. Titan ball! Casey got it out. And Big Jeff at the bottom of the pile starts wrestling a Raven, and he wins.
That was tremendous, tremendous effort. That was second and third effort. That's what you have to have.
So that's Mike Keith, Coach Dave McGinnis, Titans Radio on the call of the 2019 divisional round win against the Baltimore Ravens to send the Titans to the AFC title game against the Kansas City Chiefs and Patrick Mahomes. It was and at that point his season had already been disrupted by injury. His body was already starting to fail him. But that was such a great moment for him, for that defense, and you just hear the groans of the Ravens fans, which I'm sure gives everybody in the radio audience a special kind of delight, given the way that Titans fans hate the Ravens.
It was 21-6 at that point.
Yeah. Man, I'm telling you, watching that game, the press box in Baltimore is probably my favorite just because it's high enough above the field that you get to see everything, but it's still low enough to where you're basically, it feels like you're sitting in the middle of the lower bowl, like the middle section of the lower bowl, right above the field. So you're sitting on top of the Ravens fans, and thank God, like me and Lucas in the radio studio, there's like 8 foot of plexiglass separating you from the Ravens fans. Because not only are these guys pissed off, losing 21-6, they're drunk, they've experienced all, you know, the Enter Sandman when Lamar Jackson comes out on the field, they've got the new... In M&T Bank Stadium, they had the Alabama LED light show that they were doing pregame. It was really, really cool.
Was it cold?
I mean, actually, it wasn't that bad, if I remember correctly. Like, I had a jacket on, but like a winter coat, but it wasn't like very, very cold. It was a very comfortable game, you know, and then I immediately went to the press box, and I was fine. So I don't know, as the game wore on, if the temperature and the weather got worse, because it did start to rain at the end of that. But him in that moment and getting to do it in Baltimore in front of the Ravens fans, I think gave him a special kind of delight, and that's one of the best moments that he had in his career, certainly. 615-737-1045. So a fantastic career. Congratulations to Jurrell Casey, who retires at 1 p.m. today from the NFL after 10 seasons in the league. We're going to talk to Joey Kent coming up next about this Vols game, but I know many people are still waiting to talk about the Vols, so let's go to the phones. Dwayne is in Franklin. He wants to weigh in about the University of Tennessee. What's up, Dwayne?
Yo, the guy that called said he was from Ohio, said he's all in on being a Vols fan. I don't know what he woke up drinking, but he needs to put that back on the shelf. I'm born and raised in Tennessee, man, and I would give my left arm to trade places with, you know, with him being born in Ohio, because I'm an Ohio State fan.
So you're – oh, okay. So you live in Tennessee, but you're an OSU fan.
Oh, yeah. Born and raised here, man. Okay. And I cannot stand the Vols. Can't stand them.
Wow. Okay. So
my thing is, go Buckeyes. And I'm out.
I can't trust you, Dwayne.
Lucas could not wait to hang up on Dwayne fast enough.
You can't trust the guy who was born and raised somewhere and then just picks another team.
What? Like who's the guy in the comment section on YouTube all the time? He's like a Tennessee fan all over the place everywhere else, but he's a Colts fan?
Yeah, it's our buddy Zach Bunch.
Well,
I think.
Dude, do you know him?
No. Okay. No, he listens and interacts with us.
Oh, okay.
But I do have a good
friend.
So
your close personal friend, Zach Bunch?
No, I do not know Zach. I do not know Zach personally.
Comments on YouTube, but that was such a weird place to go with that.
I do have one close personal friend that I went to college with at UT that grew up in the Franklin, Nashville area that is a huge Vols fan, that is a Colts fan for no particularly good reason, maybe other than Peyton Manning, but still, can't trust those people. And I tell him that all the time.
You people, Lucas says, through gritted teeth, just spitting in his orange-colored glasses.
You don't get to pick your team. You're stuck with your team.
Is that how you look at this?
I'm a firm believer in that.
All right, we'll see if Joey Kent feels the same way. Coming up next, Vols legend Joey Kent joins us on the other side. I'm Buck Rising, and this is 104.5 The Zone.
104.5 The Zone and Titans Radio celebrate the career of Jurrell Casey.
Casey went ramming through there! Goff knocked loose of the ball!
Congratulations, number 99, from 104.5 The Zone.
for example, okay? Somebody who grows up, diehard, born Nashville native, but ends up being an Ohio State fan. Can you trust that person?
No, you can't. No, unequivocally, no, you cannot do that.
That's exactly how Lucas Panzeca, the producer of this show, feels, and he's been.
How does that happen? Like, how does that happen?
Listen, Joey. I mean, your football team. It's been a little while since they've reached the heights, so I don't know if people are starting to stray a little bit.
I understand that. But the last time, and it's been a while. Let me go ahead and say that from the jump. It's been a while, but the last time Tennessee and Ohio State played, Tennessee won.
That's right.
It's been a while. Been a while.
That's okay. Hey, we hold those victories over their head.
We got to take our victories when we can, though, man.
100%. So there should be a victory ahead for the Vols tonight. Bowling Green is a suffering program at this particular time. They've been paid a lot of money to come into Knoxville tonight. But I know that there are certain things, understanding that the point spread is massive and that the stakes are relatively low, Joey. What specifically are you looking to see in the first game of the Josh Heupel era as it relates to the football team?
I think it always starts with the quarterback. And, you know, we talked about Milton for a while here, right? And we kind of anticipated him being a starter quarterback. And when he was named a couple few days ago, you know, it was like, okay, that was a secret that everybody knew. But, you know, our quarterback play hasn't been, you know, it's needless to say, our quarterback play hasn't been where it should be for a while now. Basically, since Josh Dobbs, you know, Josh was, you know, I think he's probably going to go down as one of the, you know, the most unappreciated quarterbacks in Tennessee history because of what he meant to the offense and the way he kind of masked some of our deficiencies, and our quarterback situation hasn't been where it should. And you look at Milton, he has all the intangibles, right? He has the size and, you know, the arm and, you know, everything that you want in a quarterback. And, you know, we've seen him have some success in Michigan, and we've seen him not, you know, do as well as, you know, you would think he would do with all of his physical attributes, right? So we're just hoping that he is the quarterback that Tennessee's been wanting for years now. And everything that I've heard about him, you know, him being a leader off the field, you know, the way he's practiced over, you know, after spring ball and summer and this fall camp. I'm really anticipating, you know, this to see him do well with his offense.
So from that standpoint, I'm curious about Joe Milton too. And it's my understanding that he wasn't put in the best position schematically to succeed at Michigan. And this, so how I should judge him should not be based off of his body of work so far. And I'm looking forward to seeing kind of what he's capable of and really more how they utilize him right now. The benefits of tempo in an offense, Joey, are obviously we know what the benefits are. You're getting a defense to play on their heels. The advantage is to the offense as long as you understand what you are executing. And execution was a problem for this team last year. We know it's a different coaching staff. We know that the personnel is largely different. But how can they establish tempo tonight and find ways to execute at a high level with an opponent that is clearly inferior?
Yeah, I mean, the easy answer to that is just continue to get first downs, right? And first downs were just kind of hard to come by over the last couple of years. And, you know, our point production was very low. I was looking at the stats a couple of days ago. We only averaged 21 points a game.
Yeah.
Last year with Coach Heupel and his, you know, his previous program, they averaged over 40. And, you know, in this college game, you know, things have changed. You know, the days of the, you know, 24 to 17 games are pretty much over for right now. This is the kind of the football phase they're in right now, that you have to score over 30 points a game to even have a chance. And that's what I'm looking forward to in this offense, right? If you score points, we'll be competitive. And, you know, a lot of people talk about, you know, Ole Miss last year and, you know, them scoring a bunch of points and not, you know, their record didn't reflect the excitement from the program. But a lot of people kind of look over the fact that they only won 5 games last year, right?
Yeah.
We're hoping Tennessee wins more than that. But, you know, as long as you score points, I mean, you're in these games. And if the defense is, you know, improves, you know, from the standpoint of last year, I think they have better personnel. I think they're just coached better. You know, it's kind of kind of funny you say that with Jeremy Pruitt being a defensive coach and him having that background. But I think these guys like each other, man. I think, you know, I'm actually a Knoxville Buck. And
I was about to say, you're going to the game, right? But
yeah. I was at the, in the complex 45 minutes ago, and I was talking to some coaches and some players and some staff that I've known for a while. And they just said the building is different. You know, the kids like each other. They hang with each other after practice. You know, those little – when I say that, it doesn't mean a lot to people who don't, you know, play sports or haven't played team sports, but you have to – you know, you kind of have to like, you know, the guy next to you, right?
Yeah.
That's going to give you the chance to, you know, to go that extra mile for your teammate. And the building is different. The atmosphere in the, you know, and, you know, as far as the coaching staff is different. I think these kids are playing for the coaches. We'll be playing for the coaches tonight and their teammates, man. And I think it's going to be a different brand of Tennessee football that we're going to see tonight at 8.
Well, and
8 Eastern.
And there's something, and of course you can hear kickoff between the Vols and Bowling Green right here on 104.5 The Zone, 7 Central Time, for those of you listening in the Central Time Zone. I would say, though, Joey, that I think a lot of times the cliche of playing for one another gets lost on maybe the audience or people that haven't played sports at a level past high school, but there is so much truth in what you're saying there that can be easy, I think, for the uninitiated, for lack of a better term, to kind of understand.
Yeah, man, it's very important. I think, you know, I'm kind of dating myself, but, you know, when I was playing in the 90s at Tennessee, man, we liked each other. Like, I'm at Dead End Barbecue in Knoxville with, you know, 6 or 7 former teammates that, you know, we keep in contact with each other, you know, 20, 25 years later, right? And that only happens if you really loved and, you know, and appreciated your teammate back when you were playing. I just don't know how much, you know, over the previous regime, how much they enjoyed each other or enjoyed practice or enjoyed playing for that staff. And we won't have the talent, obviously, as you know, a lot of teams in the SEC, but if you, you know, it's a lot to be said for effort and wanting to do something to improve your team. And I think this, you know, the atmosphere around this program is different. The air is different. I was just talking to a secretary, Kim. She's been around for 36 years, and, you know, she's seen multiple staffs, coaches, and she was like, you know, it's just different. You know, it's just different. And it's kind of hard to put your finger on different, you know, quote unquote different,
yeah.
But she was saying in a positive way that, you know, it's still going to take some time because we don't have the talent, you know, the way we, you know, what we did in the past. But the coaching staff is approaching this team a little bit different because I think they realize how this team was affected the last couple of years and how they were treated and kind of beat down, and they took a different approach. And even though they're still, you know, they're still coaching these guys like hell, right? They're still coaching them. But they're taking a different approach, and I think it's working.
Yeah, it seems to be the theme that you hear from a lot of former players from the Pruitt era and guys who have kind of survived that transition from Pruitt to now Josh Heupel. Joey Kent, VFL, here with us on 104.5 The Zone. We're talking about the Vols and Bowling Green tonight at 7 p.m. Central Time. Check out Joey's podcast, Three the Pro Way, with this week featuring Kings of Leon bass guitarist, which is a very, very enjoyable conversation. I think you guys have done such interesting interviews, Joey, that I'm excited that people are getting to hear more of those conversations between people that you come in contact with over the course of your time in this state. But sticking with the University of Tennessee right now, I don't think that there's a more important player on this roster, non-quarterback division, than Jalen Hyatt. I think he was so underutilized last year. I think that he does display that game-breaking potential. It was just they didn't really use the freshman under Pruitt, and I thought that was always questionable to me. How much can they stand to benefit from this player, and what kind of stands out about him to you?
Yeah, he's probably one of the happiest players on the team when Heupel was named head coach. And his mom and dad, I was just talking to him at the restaurant that we're in right now. I want to see more from him. He's extremely talented. The practice that I saw during spring practice this year, nobody could stay in front of him. He's quick. He's fast. He looks slight, but he can do everything that you want a receiver to do. I want to see him. You know, you know he can go on a go route. You can run a deep post. You know we can do all those things. I want to see him be a more of a complete receiver. And I'm saying this like the last couple years. That's no fault of him because he was doing what the offense kind of dictated and what was asked of him. I want to see him run curls. I want to see him run shallow crosses across the middle, take a shot. You know, I want to see all that because we know he can run, right? And he's going to benefit from his speed, but he can do so much more because he's that athletic, and I think he's that talented. As far as the rest of the receivers, Tillman, you know, Jones, Holloway, all those guys are going to benefit from this offense. And I can't wait, man. You know, this is a receiver's dream, this offense. And the only thing, the caveat to that is a lot of people just think it's just throwing the ball all over the lot, but it's not. It's just an up-tempo offense, but they run the ball as well. So, you know, Swallow's going to see, you know, he's going to see some opportunities with, you know, just the way they align. They have wide splits. They do a lot of things offensively that I'm excited for the rest of the country to see.
Yeah, definitely a run-based offense under Josh Heupel if it's to look anything like it did at UCF. Joey Kent here with us on 104.5 The Zone. So on the other side of the ball, Joey, when we talk about this kind of talent disparity right now, and this is not to take a shot at the guys who are playing defense for this university at this point, but there has clearly been attrition, particularly at the linebacker position. That's probably where they're hurting the most as far as depth is concerned. Understanding that Bowling Green, again, has struggled mightily in the last couple of seasons, and this is a clearly inferior opponent, what from a defensive execution standpoint do you need to see from this group tonight?
I just want to see them play fast. You know, from what I understand, you know, Pruitt ran a pretty complicated defense to some, right? And when you have to think on defense, that's the worst thing. It really, on, you know, offense or defense, particularly on defense. If you're thinking on defense, I mean, there's no way you can be successful. And I think they've simplified, not necessarily, you know, schematically, but it's just a different sense of accountability on defense now. The last couple of years, you wouldn't think that a defensive-minded coach would be, you know, that side of the ball would be as bad as it was. And not saying we're going to be, you know, that much better, But I do think they're going to play faster and they're going to be more confident. And, you know, you have a guy like Rodney Garner. He was here with me when I was in school. He's been around the league, you know, for decades now. He's one of the best defensive line coaches in the college football. Last year they necessarily didn't have a coach. Coach Pruitt was coaching him, plus being a defensive coordinator. So you have a dedicated defensive line coach that's going to get after those guys, been successful, knows what he's doing. I think it's going to make a difference, man. I just want to see them play fast, play confident, and go after the ball.
Joey, we think we know what we're going to get, right, from Jalen Hyatt and Valus Jones as far as how involved they're going to be in this offense. Probably the biggest question mark at that position is who emerges as that go-to third target. And you've seen names like Cedric Tillman and Javonte Payton, maybe some of the younger guys pop up. I know you've been to practices. I know you've seen this team a little bit. Where have your eyes really been drawn to when you think about that third option at receiver behind Jones and Hyatt?
Yeah, you know, anytime I talked to one of the coaches when I was at that spring ball, they mentioned Tillman. He was the guy that was emerging. And I didn't realize how big he was. He's a pretty big guy, 6'3", 6'4", over 200 pounds, but can run. I think what initially got him was the lack of confidence and lack of targets. And it seems to me that they're going to try to get him the ball. I like Payton, too, because of the experience. He's fast. He's physical. He plays with an attitude. Has a lot of swag, man. So I think he's going to bring a lot to the table. We have a pretty solid receiver group, right? You know, with some talent and some experience, a good mix of talent and youth and experience, right? So I'm looking forward to seeing those. They're going to get the ball, right? Hopefully, Milton will put the ball in a place where they can make something happen after the catch. And you know, you see Callaway, you see, you know, Jennings, you see a lot of these guys that are playing in the league now that are making plays in the NFL but didn't necessarily show that here. And a lot of times because the ball placement, you know, they were jumping for balls. The balls weren't in a place where they can make something happen after it. So that's, you know, going back to Milton, that's what I'm looking forward to. We all know he can throw it, you know, 60, 70 yards. He can, you know, he can do that. I want to see the touch. I want to see the ball placement. You know, that's what the good quarterbacks do. They just know how to throw the football, where to put it, so you can be the most successful after you catch it. So hopefully Milton can, you know, find that touch. And, you know, from what I understand, he's vastly improved on that. That's going to be important in this offense. You got to put the ball where the receiver can make something happen after it. And we can do that, man. We'll be good to go.
Joey Kent here with us on 104.5 The Zone, talking Vols and Bowling Green. All right, Joey. So this has been a weird conversation for me to have all day long because I come from a different part of the country. College football is not in my background, in my blood at all. Uh-huh. I went to Indiana University. We went to the tailgates to drink and then to go home and watch the SEC. After
that's not a bad plan, though, Buck.
No, it worked out swimmingly. But, like,
it's not a bad plan, man.
Joey, the only college football game I've ever seen is working a couple of Vanderbilt games when I first started out and I was broke and I needed the money. Describe for me the atmosphere that I'm missing out at with 102,000 people at Neyland Stadium.
Man, it really depends on the decade and the years, right? I mean, when you're winning, it's no other place like Rocky Top. Like, it's no other place. A big game. I've been to a lot of places. You know, you look at LSU. You know, that's an electric atmosphere. You know, Ohio State, all those big time programs. But when Tennessee is rolling. You know, this is still a small, you know, a small town, right? And everywhere you go, you see orange. And game days on big days, man, it's nothing like. And I can't wait for these kids. Like, for the last 10, 12 years, you know, these athletes had a, you know, a semblance of success and a couple big games that they, you know, won here and there. But they haven't felt, you know, they don't know what it feels like to – be in a city, be in a stadium when it's rocking and you're winning games, you know, convincingly and beating big teams, right, and big programs. It's really nothing like it, man. It's a special place. That's why I'm here today, to kind of experience it. And, you know, Heupel's first game and a lot of my teammates are here. And, you know, the one thing that I really wanted to mention that the statue dedication this morning. That's the reason why I was here early this morning.
Right.
You know, T. Martin and Lester McClain and Condridge Holloway and Jackie Walker. I mean, that dedication ceremony was amazing because those guys, you know, they set the tone for, you know, the black athlete and at the University of Tennessee. And Tennessee was basically a trailblazer in black athletes and putting them on positions where they can succeed, man. And so, It was a great morning. It's emotional for me because, you know, my relationship with T. Condridge is from my hometown of Huntsville, Alabama, right? So, you know, you have two Alabama guys standing, you know, with a statue in front of Neyland, which is, you know, which is funny and special at the same time. Then you have Jackie Walker being from Tennessee and Lester McClain, great Lester McClain from Nashville, right? So it was a awesome morning. Going to tailgate myself this afternoon and enjoy that myself and ready to see the balls later on at 7 o'clock.
First black starting quarterback to start in the SEC, the first black player to score a touchdown in the SEC, the first black All-American in the SEC, and the first black quarterback to lead an SEC team to a national championship. Those are the men that were honored today and now have statues outside of the stadium. I imagine that had to be such a cool moment.
It was awesome, man. I've never met Lester McClain, and I just walked. You know, I just had a conversation with him. You know, an hour ago, I just told him thank you, right? And because he meant a lot, you know, to a lot of people. He paved the way for a lot of us, and just have a chance to have a conversation with him and Jackie Walker's family. You know, it's, you know, talking to Conjures, I've known Conjures since I was little, and, you know, just, you know, so happy for him and his family. And it's, again, Tennessee is a special place, man. And you know, if we get football right, man, I can't wait to see, because we're gonna have to fool. If Tennessee starts winning again, all the jokes and all all the stuff that we've gone through over the last decade or so, if we start winning again, it's gonna take some time. But once we do, it's gonna be fun times on Rocky Top again.
No question, Joey Kent, Vols legend, three the pro way. Check it out in your favorite podcast app. Hey, man, enjoy the game. Thank you so much for taking some time. Get back to your lunch. We'll leave you alone.
All right, brother. All right, bud. Y'all take care, man.
Joey Kent, one of the best, here with us on 104.5 The Zone. Polls next.
The Josh Heupel era begins on Rocky Top as the Vols host Bowling Green.
Man there in the end zone. Touchdown, Tennessee. Jalen Hyatt, he outran the Alabama secondary.
Bob Kessling has the kickoff on the Vol Network. Tonight at 7 on your home for the Vols. 104.5 The Zone.
that out. The Vols tonight, told you I bet Bowling Green plus 35. I think that that is too big of a line for me not to pass up. But again, it's about competency. It's about execution. And if they don't show those two things, well, then I think we're going to have a hell of a show tomorrow. In the meantime, polls.
Oh, Nelly, this is Keith Jackson talking about college football. It's time to stop the count. The polls have closed, and the granddaddy of them all has been tallied with your poll update. Oh, Nelly, talking about Buck Rising show producer and daily correspondent, Lucas Panzeca.
What is the one thing you need to see from the Vols tonight? Tucker says points, a lot of them, please.
Yes, points. Points would be expected. Points would be absolutely necessary. And, you know, here, outside of points, like, I don't just want to see big plays. Like, I don't want to see 60-yard, 70-yard touchdowns would be great. Like, I want to see what they look like in the red zone. Because that was one thing that the Vols did well last year, surprisingly, was operate in the red zone for as bad as that offense looked everywhere else on the field.
Because the only thing they could do was run the ball. And when they decided to throw the ball, it ended up in interceptions or pick sixes.
Correct.
Henry, quarterback play well. Verbatim. Quarterback play well.
Quarterback play well. Vols play football. Color is orange. Yes. Quarterback play well would be a necessary situation for Tennessee tonight.
DJ says failure. That would be ideal.
Why? Ooh, maybe a Bama fan? Maybe a Georgia fan? A closet Kentucky fan, perhaps.
What are you most concerned about with the Vols tonight? Josh says winning.
Listen, head on a swivel, all right? We all lived the Georgia State experience not that long ago. It's when Lucas was rattling off those ridiculous Bowling Green stats that we had earlier. I was just sitting there thinking, like, this sounds like Georgia State.
Yeah, I will say Georgia State went on to have a pretty decent year that season. Eldon says the entirety of the defense.
Yeah, the defense is a concern. I fear their pass rush will be not enough. I fear their linebacker depth is incredibly thin and lacking talent. I fear that their secondary can't cover, which means that I fear the entirety of the defense.
I think they feel good about the front end of that secondary, but depth-wise, it's a struggle. Everything else you said, pinpoint. Jay Mullen says the ad nauseum discussion of them for the next 3 months. Strap in, Jay.
Well, Lucas isn't going to let it die, so you just better be prepared for that particular situation. Listen, here's what I'll say, okay? The Vols being good is good for us. It's good for this show. So you want this show to be entertaining. You want the Vols to be good. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't sprinkle in a little disaster. Like the Georgia State thing, it wasn't the worst thing in the world for business. That's what we are. It's not like I'm rooting for disaster, but I could use a little disaster.
Yeah, it's either got to be really, really good or really, really bad. In between, that's where.
No, it can't be really, really bad because then we get apathy, and I need a little bit of juice.
Well, like dumpster fire bad, like 2017 coaching search, that's got juice.
Well, yeah, but coaching searches are different because then everybody's just out for blood.
What's your favorite Jurrell Casey memory with the Titans? V-Love says Jurrell finger wagging after after a sack while simultaneously pulling up his britches and covering up his crack.
Yeah, let's put it on the poll to end the show. Hall of Fame plumber's crack, Jurrell Casey, yes or no? I think that's what we should finish the show with. Yeah, listen, my favorite Jurrell Casey memory is the fact, just covering him, just him being a good quote, him being unafraid to say things. He got in a hell of a lot of trouble in London because he was asked a question about Kaepernick and they were not prepared for him to go off the way that he did. But to his core, he was always upfront and honest, and that was something I respect.
Lane says, after a game, I asked him to sign my Jurrell Casey Titans jersey before we got to New Jersey, and he did after he talked to his family, and he talked to me for 5 to 10 minutes. It was amazing. He was kind of known for doing that type of stuff, right?
I mean, he's just an incredibly personable human being, Jurrell Casey. And, you know, I covered him at the tail end of his career, obviously, and that's when they were winning. So I'm grateful that I got that experience and to get to see him be that kind of great on a team that was competent, a team that went to the playoffs a couple of times towards the end of his career. But yeah, he was always somebody who would give you the time, even whether you be fan who's seeking an autograph, whether you're somebody who's just trying to get in the presence of that kind of greatness, or whether you're a media member who not everybody is also always as warm to. Jurrell Casey is that kind of person.
Yeah, his honesty sticks out to me when I asked him before the AFC Championship game. I asked him what they enjoy about going on the road with this road warrior mentality, and he was like, oh, I hate it. It sucks. There's nothing. I don't enjoy anything about it.
Yeah.
Carlos says, mine's not a memory, but his chicken legs always made him even that much more impressive to me.
Again, Plumber's Crack Hall of Fame, Jurrell Casey, Chicken Legs Hall of Fame, Jurrell Casey.
Ramon told me that Mike Tomlin would tell them before playing the Titans, don't let his looks fool you. I'm paraphrasing there.
What an awful backhanded comment. That is a compliment. That's outstanding.
Crazy Pellet says, finally finding out what his sack celebration was all about. Many people laud his sack celebration, the body bag.
The toe tag, body drag, or something like that?
Toe tag, body zip. Well, okay. He zips up the body bag, right?
It's not that. Yeah.
You know what he does? Joey says the strip sack of Lamar Jackson in the 20 playoff game.
Yep. That was the best that we saw of Jurrell Casey from that run, because his body had been banged up all year long, and he was making plays all over the field. He was helped, obviously, by the presence of Jeffrey Simmons, and David Long had a great game in that, too. But, yeah, it was good to see Jurrell Casey get to shine in a divisional round against the top seed in the AFC that year.
Toe tag and body bag, yeah.
There it is.
And Matt says, when he was the only good defensive player for the Titans for about 5 years.
Just surrounded by incompetence, which made him look that much better. Yeah, Jurrell Casey, perpetually an underrated player.
What was the worst preseason omen? Vol's boat catching fire on the Cumberland, Titans field catching fire before the Eddie George, Steve McNair induction to the Ring of Honor.
Well, based on results, you would say that it would be the Vol Navy boat catching fire because the Titans went to the AFC Championship game.
56% say it was the Vol's boat.
But there's 44% of people that look at it. I did the math right. 44% of people that are looking at this and saying, yeah, the field catching on fire when they inducted Eddie and Steve into the Ring of Honor. Not great.
Yeah, the Vols boat preceded the Georgia State loss, so that was obviously the worst preseason omen. But yeah, maybe the Titans won a little more dangerous, considering the amount of people that were around.
Yeah, and people sprinting towards the flames with fire extinguishers like they're going to be able to put out the pyrotechnics.
Heroes.
Yeah, okay.
Those are the polls.
All right. Fantastic show today. We will have Jurrell Casey's press conference. We'll carry it live on the air for you during Blaine and Mickey, so you'll enjoy that and get to hear him in his final moments as an NFL player retiring as a Titan. An incredibly cool moment. Vols fans, enjoy the game tonight. We will react to it at length tomorrow. John Reed will be here. Coach Mack will be here. We'll have a great time together. And you'll continue to have a great time this afternoon because Blaine and Mickey are up next.
Mike Keith and Coach Mack bring every Titans game to your smartphone. Hear every game.
There's your answer.
By downloading the 104.5.